We welcome you back. Roch Kubatko from MASNsports.com joins us right now for a little update on possible rumors. Let's talk about the, you know, what the players or possibly the Orioles would be willing to give up right now that are, you know, having a decent season.
Yeah, trade value up. It's one of those things with the rebuild. Every time somebody's doing well, you think, hey, that's great. And you think, I wonder what they could get for him. That's kind of where we are right now. We start with Andrew Kasher, somebody they certainly would move. They're not, they're looking right now still to reduce some payroll. And you'd be selling high right now with Kasher. Five quality starts this season, three in a row. His velocity's up. I've seen him sitting at 96 with a fastball, and he touched 97 last night. He gets the $10 million option if he has a combined 340 innings in these two seasons. I think he's around 207 right now. So certainly he's a name that's going to keep coming up as you get closer to the deadline. And there are teams that could be interested in him as a starter or even a bullpen guy because he's done both. So certainly he's enhancing his value, and that's a good thing for the Orioles. Michael Givens, forget what happened last night. Teams have been asking about him multiple years now at the winter meetings, at the deadline. The Orioles have wanted to hold on to him. But this is a new regime, and no one's untouchable, and he's got a really quality arm that teams are intrigued by. They love the controllability factor, somebody who's not going to be a free agent for a while yet, and is salary friendly, and they look at him as somebody that could be a dominant seventh inning guy, set up and with closer experience. So his value was still high despite what happened last night. And Trey Mancini, it's going to be an ongoing debate. Is that somebody that you try and wrap up long term, hold on to him, or do you sell high with a guy like that as well? Because again, no one's untouchable, and there are plenty of teams that would be interested in Trey. Face of the franchise or big trade chip? That's something the club's going to have to decide because, again, right now they're not really looking to add any type of payroll. So his name's going to have to be included in that category. And even a Dylan Bundy, if he can string together starts like the last one that he's had, I think they've got a better opportunity there that they could move him. And plus, I think I kind of call it the Jake Arrieta, Kevin Gausman factor, Zach Davies, you can name others where teams say, hey, other starters have left there that have underachieved, gone somewhere else and blossomed. Maybe we can do the same thing with Dylan. That could happen as well. So the Orioles have to decide what to do there. But that's another guy that if he pitches well, like he did this last outing, his name's going to come up.
How about some of the value of the trade chips that have gone down?
I mean, you always have to look really injuries, and that's a big cause. And, you know, starting with Alex Cobb, someone with 3 years left on his deal, the Orioles really were looking to move him. And I think if you hooked up Alex to a lie detector, he'd say, hey, a contender sounds appealing as opposed to being in a rebuild for three more years. But, of course, he's down now rehabbing in Sarasota. There's no timetable for when he'll even get on a mound at this point. So that's kind of gone out the window. And you look at a Nate Carnes, somebody that they signed a one-year deal but thought that's somebody that maybe they could also flip at the deadline. He's on the 60-day injured list and not close to coming back at this point, of course. That's why they moved him to the 60. And he's had some, you know, health issues the last few years or durability concerns. The Orioles were hoping they could get some contributions from him and then have interested teams. And then you look at a Mark Trumbo, who certainly they'd be happy to move. Last year of his contract, he's playing an extended spring training, but not close at this point to coming back. He's going to have to go out on a rehab assignment, so you're not going to get much interest there. And then a guy like Dan Straley, it's not a health issue, but they acquired Straley. They signed him hoping that maybe he could provide innings, ease some of the burden on young starters in the rotation, and then a guy you could maybe flip at the deadline, and that hasn't worked out at this point. He's got an 8.51 ERA, 18.91 whip. He's not pitching deep into games. So really it's performance that's hurting that cause right now.
Now, Roch, Ryan Mountcastle's had a pretty good season at Norfolk. He's been hitting around .320. What about his defense?
See, that's it. He's really hitting well. People are like, oh, that's great. But they want to know how he's playing first base. It's his third position now. And by the way, he's only 22 and he's really hitting well. We should mention .325, .353, .519 slashing in 39 games, 11 doubles, 6 home runs, 29 RBIs. But how's the defense? Brandon Hyde talked to Gary Kendall, the Tides manager, again this past week and said, really, the reports have been good. He's doing well at first, still learning the position. Not as easy as a lot of people think where you just run to the bag and take a throw. There's a lot of things that are involved there, these learning, but I think there's some encouragement that maybe that could be his position. It wasn't shortstop. There were concerns about the arm. Third base never quite got comfortable there as well. So first, there is an opportunity there. And, you know, we could see him later this summer. summer, even though they've been erring on the side of development. But the thing is, and I had somebody in the organization say this, you know, we have a lot of first base DH types, so making room for Ryan Mankowski could be a little bit tricky in that regard. But unless you want to move him to the outfield, they have plenty of corner outfielders as well. It's going to have to be first base, and that's where they continue to work with him. But defense right now looks like it's pretty good, and they're encouraged by how he's playing.
Always great information from Roch Kubatko. Check him out at MASN Sports.com, School of Rock.